Hi guys, in this video we are going to cover an important RBI notification which was there in the news recently, and this notification relates to the relief which has been granted to the MSME borrowers who are registered under GST with regard to the recognition as non-performing asset. So before moving, let's first look at the relevance of this topic with respect to our examination. So this topic is relevant for both NABARD as well as the RBI examination. So in the NABARD, this can be linked to the ESI portion under the subtopics reforms in banking financial sector, industrial and labor policy, and in RBI this can be linked to the FM portion under the subtopics risk management in banking sector and the recent developments in financial sector. So this was in the headlines recently that RBI has provided relief to MSME borrowers under GST. And there was a notification dated 7th of February 2018 regarding the same, and it dealt with the subject that a big relief has been granted to the stressed MSME enterprises in the country, as RBI has said that the loans up to rupees 25 crores which are disbursed to concerned MSMEs would now be classified or non-performing assets after 180 days. So some relaxation has been granted with regard to the recognition of NPAs with regard to MSMEs which are registered under GST. So what does the notification exactly say? So now let us look at the notification and what the notification has to say. So presently, the notification states that the banks and NBFCs in India generally classify a loan account as a non-performing asset based on 90-day and 120-day delinquency norms respectively. So it states that presently NPAs are recognized if there is a default in the repayment of dues for by banks beyond the period of 90 days and by NBFC beyond the period of 180 days. So it has been represented to us. So RBI says that some representations have come to us which say that formalization of business through registration under the GST regime has adversely impacted the cash flows of the smaller entities during the transition phase, with consequent difficulties in meeting their repayment obligations to banks as well as NBFCs. So this representation has been made to RBI that people are, especially those working in the MSME sector, they are not able to meet their dues timely, and this is because now the MSMEs have to move to the new regime, that is the GST regime, and in the transition phase their cash flows are a bit affected, their operations are a bit affected. So till the operations smoothen out, there should be some relaxation which should be given to them with regard to recognition of NPAs. So in this particular regard, and as a measure of support to these entities in their transition to a formalized business environment, it has been decided that exposures of banks and NBFCs to a borrower classified as MSME under the MSME Act 2006 shall continue to be classified as a standard asset in the books of banks and NBFCs subject to certain conditions. So the notification says even beyond the 90-day and 120 period, the advances which are given to the MSME sector would remain a standard asset. It would not become an NPA if some conditions are complied with. Now let us look at what are the specified conditions in which the relief will be granted to the MSME borrower. So these are the conditions. So the first condition is that borrower has to be registered under the GST regime. So this is the basic prerequisite condition, that the borrower has to be registered under the GST regime as on 31st of January 2018. The next condition is that the aggregate exposure, including non-fund based limits of banks and non-banking financial companies or NBFCs to the borrower, does not exceed rupees 250 million as on 31st January 2018. So the loans or advances which have been granted to this particular borrower should not exceed rupees 250 million as on 31st of January 2018. And a broader view has to be taken with regard to the loans and advances and all the non-fund based facilities, for example sub-guarantee etc. is also given. It will also be included in calculating this limit of 250 million. The borrower's account was standard as on 31st August 2017. So this is the date just after the introduction of GST. And it says that the borrower's account has to be standard as on 31st of August 2017. So initially it was, it has to be a standard account and not an NPA account. Next condition is that the amount from the borrower overdue as on 1st September 2017 and the payments from the borrower due between 1st September and 31st January 2018 are paid not later than 180 days from their original due dates. So it also says that okay, we will not classify that account as an NPA, we will allow you to classify it as a standard account, but the payment has to be received within 180 days from the respective original due dates. So we have extended the period, but we are not extending the period beyond 180 days. It further says a provision of 5% has to be made by the banks NBFCs against the exposures which are not classified as NPA in terms of this circular. So if as a result of this circular you are not classifying an account as an NPA, you have to make a provision of 5%. Further it says the additional time is being provided for the purpose of asset classification only and not for income recognition. So this is an important point. It says that though your asset can remain standard beyond the usual 90-120 day norm, but this is only with regard to asset classification and this will not extend to income recognition. So now we have to understand that income recognition norms are a bit different when it comes to non-performing assets, and on non-performing assets income is recognized only when it is received and not when it becomes due. So this is why it states that the income will continue to be recognized when it is received and not on due or accrual basis. That is, if the interest from the borrower is overdue for more than 90-120 days, the same shall not be recognized on accrual or as due basis. So this is another important conditions. So these were the specified conditions which have been put for recognition, keeping the MSME account as a standard account and not recognizing it as an NPA. Now let us recap about some important concepts which were used in this particular notification. For example, the first and the foremost one is goods and services tax, which is a nationwide indirect tax reform and one of the biggest tax reform undertaken since independence. So this GST came into effect from the 1st of July 2017 and it is a destination based indirect tax. This GST is a multi-stage tax because tax is collected at multiple stages. So if you are purchasing goods from the manufacturer and selling goods to the retailer, you will be paying tax to the wholesaler and ultimately retailer will be paying tax to you and finally the consumer will be paying tax to the retailer. So this is a multi-stage tax collection mechanism which makes it more secure. Also, the GST shifts the entire tax burden near to the consumer. So being a destination-based tax, the entire burden is going to be on the consumer of the goods and services, and this GST is also going to benefit the industry in the long run through better cash flows and better working capital management. Also, this introduction of GST, the most important aspect of this introduction is that it has replaced many indirect taxes which were earlier being imposed by the central and state governments. So now you do not have to comply with the multiple indirect tax laws with regard to center and state. Now there is only one law which you have to comply with, that is goods and services tax. So this is how the chain of tax and input credits under the GST work. Suppose if the GST rate on a commodity is 6%, so if the wholesaler is purchasing that commodity from the manufacturer, he will be paying 6% GST on the price charged by the manufacturer, and ultimately when he sells that commodity to retailer, he will again be charging 6% GST from the retailer and it will be paying the same to the government. Now the entire 6% GST will not be paid to the government. This wholesaler will be entitled to take the credit of the GST which he has already paid to the manufacturer. So this is the mechanism of input tax credit. So for retailer also similar is the case. Now retailer purchases the goods from the wholesaler and is paying 6% GST to the wholesaler, and he is selling the goods to the consumer at a higher price and is again collecting 6% GST from the consumer, which will be deposited to the government. Now again, this 6% will not be entirely deposited to the government. This retailer will be taking credit of the taxes which he has already paid at the wholesaler level. And finally, the ultimate tax burden will be borne by the consumer only. So these are the different taxes which have been subsumed under GST. At the central level, excise duty, which was imposed on manufacturing of goods, a service tax, which was imposed on rendering of services, and other taxes like additional duties of excise and custom, special additional duty, central surcharge and cesses, central sales tax have been subsumed under GST. At the state level, VAT or the sales tax and the luxury tax, entry tax, entertainment tax, tax on advertising, lotteries, betting and gambling, state surcharges and cesses have been subsumed under GST. An important aspect to be remembered is that basic custom duty has not been subsumed under GST because this relates to the international trade and we are not yet fully having control over the international trade framework because there are several other regulations, for example, regulations of WTO, which are also having control over the same. Now next is the registration under GST. So we studied in the notification that MSME has to be registered under the GST. So when do we need to register under GST? Now in the GST regime, business whose turnover exceeds rupees 20 lakhs and this is rupees 10 lakhs for the northeastern and hill states, they are required to register as a normal taxable person or they are required to obtain registration under GST. So if your turnover, which basically means your total receipts from the business, are exceeding rupees 20 lakh, you have to obtain a registration under GST. And all the businesses that successfully register themselves under GST, they are assigned a unique goods and services tax identification number, also known as GSTN. So this number they are allotted for successfully registering under the GST regime. So this GSTN is a 15 digit PAN based identification number and it is allotted to all the entities that are registered under the GST regime. Now let us also briefly recap the concept about NPAs or non-performing assets. Now an asset becomes non-performing when it ceases to generate income for the bank or financial institution. So if the bank or financial institution is not getting the interest payments or the principal on the loan is not being repaid, then that particular advance will be classified as non-performing asset. Now let us also briefly look at the NPA recognition framework for banks. Now banks recognize a loan or advance as NPA when any of these conditions is satisfied. For example, if the interest and or installment of principal remains overdue or unpaid for a period of more than 90 days, then that term loan will be regarded as a non-performing asset. If there is an overdraft or a cash credit facility which is given and it remains out of order, that is, the outstanding balance continuously remains in excess of the sanctioned limit for 90 days. And if the bill remains overdue for a period of more than 90 days in case of the bills purchased and discounted. And for the agricultural loans, if the installment of principal or the interest remains overdue for two crop seasons for short duration crops and for one crop season for long duration crop, then again it will be recognized as NPA. And in case of other related facilities, for example, there is a liquidity facility, and in case of derivative transactions, again a period of 90 days has been given for recognizing NPAs. We need not go into much detail for these ones. So basically we have to remember that if the amount remains unpaid for more than 90 days, then that account will be classified as a non-performing asset. And for the purpose of crop loans, this period is two crop seasons for short duration crops and one crop season for long duration crops. So this is about the basic NPA recognition framework for banks. Now let us also look at the NPA recognition framework for NBFCs. Now until 2014-15, NBFCs continued to recognize their advances or the loans where the borrowers have defaulted in the payments for 180 days or more as NPAs. So until 2014-15, the period for recognizing NPAs was not 90 days as in case of the banks, but it was 180 days for NBFCs. Now in order to bring the asset classification norms on par with the banks, in which there is a 90 day cutoff, the RBI directed NBFCs to implement tighter NPA norms, though in a phased manner. So RBI decided that in a phased manner, NBFCs are also required to maintain tight NPA norms. So this was to be achieved as follows. It was to be 150 days period by the end of March 2016, 120 days by the end of March 2017, and 90 days by the end of March 2018. So this is about the NPA recognition framework of NBFCs. Now, due to this tightening of the norms relating to NPA for non-banking financial companies, this has led to steady deterioration in the asset quality of NBFCs over the past few years. So, due to the more stricter norms, now the NPA level has increased for NBFCs. Now, the income which is recognized with respect to NPAs, it is not recognized on accrual basis or on due basis. It is recognized only when it is actually received. So you will not recognize your interest income simply because it is due. You will only recognize that interest income only when you actually receive that particular interest if your account has become an NPA. Now, NPAs are further subcategorized into different categories. For example, there is a substandard asset, an asset which remains NPA for less than or equal to 12 months, doubtful asset which remains in the above category for 12 months or more, loss asset, an asset where loss has been identified by the bank or the RBI, however there may be some value remaining in it and therefore loan has not been completely written off. So they are further recognized into different subcategories like substandard, doubtful or loss assets, and on the basis of this categorization there are different amounts of provisioning which needs to be done in respect of these assets. Now, we are not going into much detail in this particular video, but this framework we have to always keep in mind. Now let us also briefly look at some of the other recent relief measures which have been introduced for MSMEs. Now in the recently presented Union Budget, Finance Minister Honorable Mr. Arun Jaitley has announced some relief measures to give boost to the MSME sector. So it has been decided that the corporate tax rate for MSMEs or for companies with turnover up to rupees 250 crores is to be reduced to 25%. So this is a key change. RBI has also recently removed the credit cap on MSME in the services sector under the priority sector. So this is an important step and this has been already discussed by us in a separate video. Also, it has been decided that the sub-targets for priority sector lending to small and marginal farmers as well as the micro enterprises shall also be applicable for foreign banks with 20 and above branches from financial year 2018-19. Now this again has also been discussed in a separate video by us, so you guys can refer those videos also as these also contain some important notifications. Now what is the impact of the recent moves which have been introduced by the RBI? Now GST was compounding the challenges for MSMEs as they had to make a transition to the new taxation regime. So the new measures or the relief measures which have been given are expected to provide some respite to the MSMEs. And also this bold step will also promote formalization of MSMEs. So if the MSMEs were earlier wary of registration under GST, simply because they will now have to do some more compliances and at the same time maintain their accounts as performing with the banks, so now they can get some relief on this front and they can easily take registration under GST. Also, the forbearance on NPAs will go a long way towards improving the cash flow levels as well as help banks in managing their delinquency levels. So it will also have an impact on the performance of banks. And also the removal of current cap of MSMEs will also help the banks seamlessly increase the priority sector lending portfolio. So there was this change with regard to the removal of the cap for MSMEs in service sector with regard to priority sector lending. So this will also help bank increase their priority sector lending portfolio. Now let us look at some of the important MCQs based on the topic we have just covered. Recently, RBI has provided some relief measures to which of the following groups by relaxing NPA norms to smoothen the transition process under goods and services tax. Options are small and marginal farmers, micro, small and medium enterprises, listed companies, or none of the above. So this we have seen that this is the most basic aspect of this particular video, that MSMEs have been granted some relief. So here answer would be option number B. Next question. For claiming relaxation under the RBI notification relating to relief for MSME borrowers under GST vis-a-vis NPA recognition, which of the following condition needs to be satisfied? The borrower is registered under the GST regime as on 31st January 2018. The borrower's account was tended as on the August 31, 2017. The aggregate exposure of banks and NBFCs to the borrower does not exceed Rs. 250 million as on 31st of January 2018 or all of the above. So this we have seen that these all are the conditions which need to be satisfied for taking relaxation benefit under the notification. So here answer would be D, all of the above. Next question. Recently, RBI has extended overdue time period for NPA recognition to 180 days for GST registered MSME borrowers. This additional time period will apply for options are asset classification only, income recognition only, both of the above or none of the above. So this we have seen that this extended time period is only applicable for asset classification and will not have any effect on income recognition. So here answer would be option number A. Next question, which of the following is incorrect regarding goods and services tax? It came into effect from 1st July 2017. It is a destination based indirect tax. It is based on multi-stage tax collection mechanism. None of the above is incorrect. So here all these statements are correct with regard to GST. So here answer would be option number D, that is none of the above is incorrect. Next question, which of the taxes has not been subsumed under GST? Options are excise duty, service tax, entertainment tax or basic custom duty. So this we have discussed that many indirect taxes at the central and state level are now subsumed under GST. But basic custom duty has not been subsumed under GST. So here answer would be option number D. Next question. For short duration crops, NPA is recognized by the banks if the installment of principal or interest remains overdue for options are 1 crop season, 2 crop season, 3 crop season or 4 crop seasons. So this we have discussed that for crop loans, if it is a short duration crop, then NPA will be classified on the basis of the amount remaining unpaid for 2 crop seasons, and for long duration crops, this period is 1 crop season. So in this case, we are being asked about the short duration crops, so the answer would be 2 crop seasons. So B will be the answer. So these are all the answers. So guys, this was all about the recent relief which has been brought for the MSME borrowers registered under the GST regime. Thank you.